God, I'm so
hey, hey, Megalyn.
I love
I'm
you.
Sorry. I guess
you
did. It was 5 a.m. A homicide had been reported from one crazy mansions up on Sunset.
Oh my God, I love you so much.
How are you?
This man is so funny. I mean, look how beautiful he is. He's one of the most handsome men I've ever met and ever been, you know, blessed to work with. But apart from that, he's so hilarious and he's immensely gifted. So I really love doing the show with John.
I mean, I've been watching and listening and knowing the stories and just knowing where, you know, some of the things that have happened to you and over the years. It's just amazing. It's incredible. Incredible that I've been a small part of your journey and continued journey. It's just incredible. Just, and I think I texted you or tweeted you the other day about something that, because she was talking about, if I remember correctly, about her first couple of things she was doing on Broadway. And the first thing that I ever saw, I call her Betty Betania Buccalania. that was what I named her when we were doing Sunset in London. And
I went to see you in, what's the name of that show with the helicopter?
The Saigon.
Saigon, sorry. So I went to see John in that. We were, this is before we were working on Sunset. And he was so funny. And so we were talking about going up. I don't know if you remember this story. I wrote it on Instagram the other day, but you didn't comment. So I don't know if you got the message. But I thought this was so clever. We talked about how terrifying it is when you go up in a Broadway show, you know, when you've done it 8 times a week for a period of time. And John, don't worry. What I do is I just keep mouthing like I'm singing and it's all in the microphone. It's all in the engineer. And he's like, and I just pretend. And he did this in Miss Saigon. And his mic guy is like on the board, like, what's going on? I thought that was so smart.
Yeah. Just away. Do you remember in Sunset, I know you'll remember this because, oh my God, it was like the show came to what it couldn't stop because in, like most sing through musicals where music doesn't stop, you have to continue on,
yeah.
Obviously. Except there was a part in Sunset when I come up behind in the you know, enormous home, you're on the phone to Betty Schaefer.
Right, I remember this in detail.
All people are stunned because you're giving all the drama going, Betty. I want you to get 10,086. You're saying the whole speech. I don't remember it, but I remember I'm supposed to grab the phone from your hand and I'm supposed to then give the address to Betty Schaefer.
It's the plot.
It's all enough to get her there.
Right.
And this, I don't know what happened, but this one show, I just walked on. Betty's giving it, you know, Betty Schaefer. And I just grabbed the phone from her and I hung up.
He hung up the phone and I'm like, oh my God, she doesn't have the address. What are we going to do? Now the cue is the phone hang up and then the stage manager pushes the computer and the house, this thunderstorm starts and the music, the conductor's playing this wild thunderstorm music and the house starts floating up and we're supposed to have this like mime, you know, about this thing, this kind of, it's a mime in silence of our struggle. And then I run back upstairs and do this big costume change. But we have, so he hangs up the phone and I'm like, you know, the address. So I call her back while the thunderstorm's going on, right? It's like wild and crazy. And I go, Betty Schaefer, someone wants to talk to you. And I'm ringing the phone and he looks at me like, what? He knew he'd done something wrong, but he didn't know what it was. And I was like, dude, like, and I'm like, hit the phone. And he's like, he goes, and I scream at him, the address! I'm just screaming at the top of my lungs, which shocked him. And he grabbed the phone, and he went, 10,086 Sunset Boulevard. And I nodded at him and I ran upstairs and we didn't have time to do our mime scene. So I get to the top of the stairs and my dresser, my wig dresser say, why didn't you guys do the scene? And he was like, why didn't you why did you forget your address? And me, you know, I had to give her the address. So I come off stage at the end of the show, and the stage manager's like, why didn't you say your lines? I said, I saved the plot. And they're like giving me a bad time, right? And I'm like, it was Barrowman. And now I'm like, what the? And so I leave at the after the matinee, and there's this sweet little British schoolgirl standing outside the stage. And she goes, thank you, Miss Buckley, for saving the plot. And I was like, yes. I'll never forget that. That was amazing.
I won't. I mean, that was one of those. And I don't know what went on in my head, but all of a sudden, it just like, it was one of the, like, going up. One of those moments just went blank, and I didn't know what to do. So I just hung the phone up. And
but I think, you know what happened. The assistant director, I don't know if you remember, he was, like, constantly giving you notes.
McBain.
Yeah. Bless his heart. We love McBain. But, you know, he was, like, telling you stuff about your descent on the stairs, which was always perfect. And you were like, what, you know, you were flummoxed. It was hilarious. The thing I remember was in the British theaters, the front is air conditioned, but the backstage and the stage isn't. And you and I used to stand there playing these love scenes in the summertime, melting. We were like melting, trying to be like all lovey-dovey and sexy. And it was like hilarious looking. I remember all those moments too.
In particular, when we would do The Perfect Year.
Yes. The worst. The worst.
Was it? And you were draped in that gold outfit, and we were dancing, and just the sweat pouring off.
It was like water. It was hilarious.
Is that more donations?
More donations.
Yeah, I just sent them to you, Betty.
Great.
Okay. Anita, thank you for $36. Thank you. Grace gave us $50. The executive director of the Virginia Children's Chorus in Norfolk. Casey from Denver, $50. Miss, thank you. Thank you for your compliments. That's so beautiful. And I'm glad you like my tweets. Brian, $50. Thank you. Denise, $100. Thank you, Denise, so much. Erin, $50. And she says her favorite song that I sing is Stars and the Moon. Kathleen from Washington, D.C., $250. My donation will be directed to voting rights work to help fight against all voter suppression efforts around the country. Fantastic. Thanks, everybody. That's so awesome.
First show I ever saw you in was History of Edwin Drood.
That was a great show.
An amazing show. And I remember, and you won't probably remember because you would not have known who I was at that time, but I was with my friend Anthony Rapp, who was in Precious Son on Broadway with Judith Ivey and Ed Harris at the time. And I went to see you and took me backstage because I'd never been backstage. And I remember passing you in the staircase and I was just like, oh my God, it's Betty. And that was, and I've never forgotten that performance for me was from recordings of Cats and other things. But that one, to see you live and to see what you were doing, and then jump to when we were doing Sunset together, there was not a night that I did not sit on that sofa down on, you know, stage right, when you're coming down the staircase to sing With One Look, that I was never not in awe of being on stage with you and hearing you sing. Because when you were talking about the power of your voice that hits, that would just, it comes out, it's amazing. And for me to sit there knowing that I was a fan and had listened to you before, but to be on stage, it was just incredible. It's one of my most memorable and favorite times of my career. And I've been doing it for 30, 35 now. So, but it's amazing. I look back on that time fondly and greatly.
Thank you, John. I love you so much. I really do. I love following you on blast. It's such a blast. It's just like to look in your beautiful eyes every night and sing with you and dance with you. It was amazing.
Here's a little blast from the past. Here's a little John Barrowman back in the day.
What?
Sunset Boulevard, Headline Boulevard, getting there is only the beginning. Sunset Boulevard, Lethal Boulevard, everyone's forgotten how they started. here on Sunset Boulevard.
Yay!
It would be, there would be applause, that moment of pause, then the applause, and descend down the staircase. Remember it.
I remember. Yeah. It was amazing.
John, here's
so much fun doing that show.
Here's the song you were talking about that I got to see Betty do at Carnegie Hall. So incredible.
And say the me vowel spot on,
pure,
and all with one
that's the L to the K.
That's the way to do it. That is you know, performance perfection.
Thank you.
Okay, John, I need to bring John, you back for the Tara show. Betty, we have to bring you back for show by show.
We literally haven't even gotten to another show. A little bit of Sunset, but
we're going to do 1776 July 4th, but we need to do a whole cast. Because it's literally been an hour already. So we only got up to 1969.
Basically. Smattering of Sunset Boulevard.
So because we're raising money, we've actually raised so much tonight, because this is just some of the donations. A lot of them, people, they don't forward the receipts. Sister, for NAACP, I wanted Betty, you to sing one of your amazing social justice songs that I heard you practicing. Would you end the show with one of your amazing songs?
Sure. I love you, Barrowman.
Love you too. And I'll DM you.
Okay.
She said. Okay, we'll be back.
This is from South Pacific by Rodgers and Hammerstein. It was written in 1950. It's kind of crazy that it still applies. You've got to be taught to hate and fear. You've got to be taught from year to year. It's got to be drummed in your dear little ear. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be taught to be afraid of people whose eyes are oddly made and people whose skin is a different shade. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be taught before it's too late. Before you are 6 or 7 or 8. To hate all the people your relatives hate. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be taught before it's too late. Before you are 6 or 7 or 8. To hate all the people your relatives hate. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be carefully taught.
Wow. So great. Everyone's loving it.
Amazing. That was beautiful, Betty Lynn.
Betty, so
that was
so
appropriate. And Jacob on the piano, by the way.
So gorgeous. And as he says, such a poignant song and so important message. All right. So, yeah, we have to have you back for every single show you've ever done. We need to do, literally, Eight Is Enough, Cats, Drew, we had Kevin, Triumph of Love. We got to go everything. Yeah. Barrowman, you have so many hilarious stories. I have to have you back.
No problem.
We've got to figure out, because you're the authority, what show could Barrowman and I do together at this point in our lives?
Listen, I'm we game. Gotta,
let's game. Do something. We have to
I do, I do.
I do, I do. I don't even know it. Is it good?
It's just two people. Barbara Preston and Mary Martin. Yes, it's a whole marriage.
That's us.
Don't marriage, baby.
That's a great idea.
You've already made out on stage. Okay, that's so what am I? So we got to do closing. So Betty, you're going to be back. John, you're going to be back. Everyone, thanks for the donations. Up.
Yes.
Some closing music.
Amazing fans. All right. What are you going to play, Seth? You're going to do the credits?
I'll play Betty's theme song.
All right. Thank you.